Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Thank you again for the organizers for having me here today to be part of this wonderful event. So, building on what I said, patient advocacy groups are not very common in our region, and I think throughout the day today we heard from different parties, but very little from the patients. And this is the main reason why NFRID was established as the UAE's first patient advocacy group. And obviously we have ambitions to grow from the UAE to the GCC, to the MENA region, creating a network of individuals that are either caregivers, patients, or even parents. Throughout my experience, although very short with rare diseases, I realized that a lot of the patients talk about their story in a very negative way. They talk about their struggle, how it took them too long to be diagnosed, how they were misdiagnosed sometimes, until, you know, they sometimes lost their loved ones. However, as an outsider, I always saw the strength in these patients. I saw that they were resilient, they were strong, and they were able to fight a disease that is usually very hard to live with, and sometimes even impossible to live with. So we chose my co-founder, Yumna, who's in the audience, who's a mother of a rare disease patient. We chose the name NFRID to focus on the uniqueness of each patient rather than talking about how rare they are, but on how they are unique as an individual. And I think this is what is missing in the entire conversation, is how these patients empower themselves and empower others as well. So we need to really learn a lot from rare disease patients and work with them and give them even more tools. How can they empower others? How can they train the trainer? How can they create a network, you know, talking about early detection, genetic sequencing, and all of the things that we spoke about. So there is a lot to be done in our region. I think, you know, I usually like to work on things and projects that are challenging, and this is definitely a challenging one, but having all stakeholders like yourselves, governments, industry, you know, this is where we need to collaborate together, put our hands together, and really make a difference in the life of the patients. So with that, I think we have a remarkable story to hear from Mark about his son Ryan and how he founded the Ryan Foundation since 92, and really, you know, looking at what he has done in the US and the lessons that we can learn from him here in our region. So with that, I invite Mark to the stage. Thank you.
What a powerful day. I want to thank the leadership here in the kingdom for inviting me to come share our story, some key principles in the rare disease journey, not just in the US, but around the world. I've heard so many incredible points today that will translate not just across the kingdom, but again around the world. Speak specifically to the gift of time. All of us have been awarded a gift since birth, the gift of time. If we look back in your own life, there are certain moments in your life where you can say, this was the moment I began to dream. This is the moment that time changed for me. I picked this photo. Last Monday was my wife and I's 40th anniversary. Thank you. As you could tell from the photograph, we were probably married when we were 10 years old. We weren't quite that young. But as I look at this photograph, I look back and I say to myself, those were the moments where we began to dream. We planned our futures, as you did your own. The next 3 days, we spent planning what we would do for the rest of our lives. We would finish college, start our careers, buy a house, have children. I wanted to have 5 children, came from a large family. My wife wanted 3 children. So we decided we would have 3 children. We had it all planned out, it was perfect. And so, got our jobs, started our careers, and on April 13th, 6 years later, Ryan Dant was born. 8 pounds, 13 ounces, beautiful and healthy. Ryan would be the big brother to our other children. As he grew, he excelled. He was smart. He was funny. He was happy. He enjoyed sports. He liked baseball and football and soccer. All things were great in Ryan's life. At 3 and a half, my wife Jean and I decided to enroll Ryan in a structured daycare. That way he could learn to be around other children and learn to be the big brother. So Jean, as part of the rule, took Ryan to the pediatrician for a pre-daycare physical. Now the pediatrician was very astute. He was young, just out of medical school not long ago. And he noticed that the little boy in the blue shirt, sweatshirt and the white hat, his liver was too large. His spleen was too large. His head was too large. He was so concerned, as a matter of fact, before Gene left the office in Dallas, Texas, he turned around and he called the genetics center at Dallas Children's Hospital. And he made an appointment for Ryan to see a geneticist. The appointment was in 2 weeks. Now we know across the nation in the U.S. and probably around the world, it's almost impossible to see a geneticist in 2 weeks. Now it's 3 to 6 months in the U.S. But he pulled some favors and Ryan had an appointment in 2 weeks. I didn't go to the doctor with Ryan and Gene, because as you look at the boy with the white hat, you see there's nothing wrong with Ryan. Nothing at all. Gene went to the geneticist with Ryan. She came back and said the geneticist feels Ryan may have a genetic disease, something very serious, but he wasn't sure of it yet. So he took some tests and he'll call us back. In 3 weeks, he called us back and said that all 3 of us have to go. So I took off work because the most important thing to me at that moment was building my dreams towards my career so that we could buy a bigger house, have more children. I told Gene, there's nothing wrong with Ryan. You can look at the little boy with the white hat and see there's nothing wrong with Ryan. He's large because I'm large. That's just the way it is. And so we went to Dallas Children's Hospital. We stepped into the examination room and waited for over an hour before Dr. Lewis Weber, the geneticist at Dallas Children, opened the door and came in. But he wasn't alone. He came with a genetic counselor and a family counselor. He sat in front of us. My little boy Ryan climbed up on Jean's lap, turned around and faced her, and we faced the doctor. We have audio. We have audio on this on the video. Is there no audio? Okay. The audio is great. You should hear it. 60 Minutes is a weekly newscast in the U.S. Years later, they followed the story and they aired a segment on Ryan's journey. As we sat in front of Dr. Weber, he told us that Ryan had a genetic disorder called MPS1, mucopolysaccharidosis type 1. He told us, in a nutshell, that Ryan would suffer, he would be in a wheelchair, he would not be able to walk or play, he may be blind or deaf, he may be mentally challenged, and he would pass away within the decade. The genetic counselor then told us that any children we would have in the future would have a 1 in 4 chance of having this disease we cannot even pronounce. All of our dreams, that moment, stopped. There would be no more children. I argued with Dr. Weber. Where are the scientists who researched rare diseases like Ryan's? And why do you call it an orphan disease? Because it made no sense to me. I'd never heard of the term rare disease or orphan disease. He said, there aren't many scientists because there are so few children around the world with Ryan's disease. I also argued, where are the biotech companies? Because this is 1991, surely there are biotech companies who would develop a drug in time to save Ryan's life. After 15 minutes of arguing, Dr. Weber looked at me and said, Mr. Dance, you have to understand, your son's disease is so rare. Drug companies won't build a drug because there's no return on investment. Your son will pass away, and there's nothing we can do about it. Nothing. So for a year, that's what we did. We went home and we did nothing. Every night, we'd lie on the floor next to Ryan's bed, listen to him sleep, and wait for nothing to change. And nothing changed other than Ryan to get more ill. He began having headaches so severe he would pass out and vomit. His hands became so stiff he could no longer hold a baseball or run to play soccer. Rare disease families are told these exact same things. Often we are diagnosed and told there is nothing that can be done. There is nothing that you can do except go home and wait for the inevitable to occur. What we want and what we need from all of our scientific friends and our physicians and our biotech partners is trust. We need a path forward for trusted and valued partners. Rare disease families need partners, partners to build a future, to find those lost tomorrows. The moment Ryan was diagnosed, Jean and I and Ryan had no tomorrows. No matter what our dreams, they were gone. So this has all been covered today. So I don't think we'll cover it. These are data I found online here in the kingdom, and it's been covered many times. 6,000 to 8,000 rare diseases, and yet science has changed in the last 30 years since Ryan was diagnosed. According to the U.S. Every Life Foundation for Rare Diseases, an organization I've been board chair and a board member for the last 9 years, and NORD, the National Organization for Rare Disease in the U.S., 93% of rare diseases still have no approved therapies. Rare disease patients wait an average of 6.3 years. We heard this earlier. And the new drug development process for approval of rare disease takes an average from the bench of good science to the bedside of treatment of 15 years. Remember the moment when Jean and Ryan and I were diagnosed? The doctor said Ryan would pass away within 10 years. Most patients don't have the time. The gift of time that was given to us is gone. A recent study the Every Life Foundation did actually backs up what's already been presented today. 16.9 average number of specialists seen before a rare disease patient is properly diagnosed. 10.2 years since the rare disease diagnosis, and 16.5 years since the first sign of a rare disease. Most physicians are told in medical school, you don't have to worry about these patients because you probably will never see a rare disease patient. You won't see someone with MPS1 or SMA, perhaps. It's too rare. So the big question is, how can the government affect and drive patients in their urge to find treatment? The Orphan Drug Act of 1983 is 40 years old this year, but it changed everything in the United States. It changed everything for the FDA. Prior to 1983, only 38 drugs had been developed for rare disease by the FDA and approved. The Orphan Drug Act was passed to help stimulate the development of orphan drugs, and it provides manufacturers with three very important incentives: federal funding of grants and contracts, tax credit of 50%, although in 2018 it was reduced to 25%. We're working on that to bring it back to 50, and an exclusive right to market for 7 years. So the question then is, did the ODA work? I think it's also important to realize that the standards are still the same. In 1983, there were 2 products developed and approved. By 2019, in 1 year, there were 91. The incentives work. It's built a partnership between the patient and the government, and science, and physicians. So you might ask, what are the families you see, what are they prepared to do to find their tomorrows, to find hope? In 2020, the FDA asked for a report called The Voice of the Patient. A disease called Hunter syndrome, which is actually MPS2. Key takeaways from the Voice of the Patient summary report from an externally oriented, conducted patient survey include these 2 points. A majority of caregivers indicate that they would be willing to accept severe or life-threatening risks to gain improvement in their child's disease. Children are our future. We watch them suffer and die. We are willing to take more risks because we know at the end where they're going when there is no treatment. And I found this takeaway remarkable, but I feel the same way. The majority of those who stated this specifically acknowledged that the prognosis of the disease is death if left untreated. We know if nothing changes, nothing changes. Our child will die. And so the risk, oftentimes, is worth the reward. My wife and I laid on the floor for a year, in pain, dreaming, walking through the home that might have been with all those children, thinking about Ryan as an adult, realizing we would never see him graduate high school. We would never see him graduate college. Or date. We would never see him walk down the aisle and get married. We would never have grandchildren. These thoughts went in our mind every single night. A year after diagnosis, we did something silly. Our friends baked cookies and cupcakes, and we had a bake sale in front of a bank. We raised $342 in hopes to find a physician or a scientist who would actually develop a treatment in time for Ryan. In this building, we found this man. Had conversations in Dusseldorf, Germany, and in Orlando, Florida, who told me enzyme replacement therapy was a possibility for MPS1. But the researcher who told me that in Germany said, you don't have 2 things you're going to need. You don't have enough time, because at the time Ryan was 4 years old. You don't have enough money, because it's going to take a lot of money. But he said, it's possible. And so my wife and I flew to LA, and I thought we'd find this big, beautiful glass building, but what we found was that. A World War II era 1944 building behind the county hospital in LA. And this researcher, Dr. Emil Kakis, working by himself. Could we find hope in one researcher? Could we find hope in $342? We couldn't find hope in 342, but it gave us the opportunity to believe that something could change. No matter what, if we could just try, if we would stand up and believe that tomorrow is worth it, that Ryan's dreams are worth the effort. And so we kept pushing forward. But all we hear about the whole time, and we heard a lot today, what about the cost of the high cost of rare disease? What about when I go to D.C., and I've been there quite often, to talk to senators on the Hill, on Capitol Hill, and to Congress, I'm often asked, the rare disease treatments, how much do they cost? And my question back to the senators and congressmen is, how much does it cost to not treat? Who pays for the person's remodel of their home? And so, the Every Life Foundation for Rare Disease did a national study. What does it cost, the rare disease burden of health? We decided we would conduct the largest, most comprehensive assessment to date on anecdotal cost, on soft cost, on hard pharmaceutical cost, cost of physicians, to see what the actual cost to the economic system in the U.S. was for 1 year. Last year, we published this study. We took direct medical costs, the ones we are all aware of, the indirect costs, which is forced retirement, absenteeism, presenteeism, when the employee is at work but not focused on work, reduction in community participation. We also took the non-medical and uncovered healthcare costs, home or auto modifications. My child may be in a wheelchair. I didn't plan on that, so I have to get a new car or remodel my own. I paid daily care. Who pays for that? Insurance does not. The government does not. It comes out of our own pocket. So what is the actual cost to not treat rare disease? 1 year, 379 rare diseases, and this was out of Medicaid and Medicare in the U.S. off the medical records, electronic health records, $966 billion. Almost $1 trillion to not treat. So we often wonder, how much does the rare disease cost? How much does it cost the economy to not treat? What is it that rare patients want most and where advocates? We want treatment comes only through partnerships between patients, science, biotechs, and government. Take one of those out, treatments rarely arrive. Please understand this. Rare patients have the advocates of their parents. They're with them every single day, or their spouse, or their... A physician sees a patient 30 minutes once a year. Who has more data? Who has more knowledge of what has changed in the past 6 months, or the past month, or the past year? It's those who spend every living moment with that person. Physicians need to look beyond the obvious and consider rare as a possibility. That oftentimes doesn't happen. That's what we saw. 16 average doctors, average patients see 16 physicians. Newborn screening saves lives. We talked about that today. Without question, treating from birth changes outcomes. We also discussed gene therapy for a moment. We talk about access, coming from faraway regions to medical centers. If gene therapy works and there's a one-time treatment, how many return visits are there compared to weekly IV treatments or something like that? I honestly believe hope is found in every positive action, that together, we can find treatment for rare. I'm sad that this video is not going to play. This is a reflection of, I'll let it play without the volume. This video was taken of my son the moment of his first infusion, and my wife. We were talking about what might be, what possibly could come, with the partnerships between open people who understand that science and patients and physicians and biotechs and government can believe in the hope of a little boy, can believe that perhaps dreams can be found when partnerships are made, when positive actions as small as a bake sale, as old as a 1942 building, can actually make a difference. This is my son, Ryan. On February 13th, 1998, 8 weeks before his 10th birthday, Ryan received his first IV infusion of aldurazyme. He was in that first trial with 10 patients. Every week by week, he received the infusions, and every week by week, the little boy who was to pass away by the time he was 15, who would suffer and die, and there was nothing we could do about it, actually lived. He graduated high school. He went to college. He got a job working for the college football team, earning $8.35 an hour that he saved to buy a car. He had the dream he would find a girlfriend, that perhaps he could finish college, move out, get married, buy his own home. Do you remember the story of my wife and I laying on the bed, on the floor next to Ryan's bed when he was a little boy? In those moments, Gina and I packed all of those dreams away until this moment. Gene and Dr. Kakis and I pushed the button that started Ryan's tomorrows. He continued to grow. He made it through high school. He actually played on the baseball team. Week by week, drip by drip, Ryan's dreams came home. All because of the moments in the county hospital just outside LA. Ryan's talking here about the emails and texts and Facebook contacts he gets from patients with MPS and other disorders based on the therapy built by MPS1, Fabry, Pompe, Hunter, Morchio, Meritolomei, Sly syndrome, all have ERTs. That's his college symbol. All have ERTs based off that first little blue building behind the county hospital. On Ryan's graduation day from the University of Louisville, the newspaper there ran an article titled "Family's Fight Changed the World." The world was ready for new science because biotech came in and government partnered and the patients were willing to fight. At his college graduation and his high school graduation was his favorite scientist and physician, Dr. Emil Kakis. July 3rd, 2021, Ryan and Sylvia Ramirez walked down the aisle and got married. There on the second row on the groom's side was his favorite scientist, Dr. Emil Kakis. In the first row was his mom and dad, both crying like babies. Because this was the dream that we were dreaming of when he was born. And we had the time to think all things are possible with this little boy. This was the dream we packed away because it wasn't going to happen because he was going to suffer and he was going to die. But when we together we believe that science can change everything, that partnerships with biotech and government and patients and physicians can change everything, lives will change. Futures will happen. Dreams will come true. A bit ago, someone said, the kingdom here has a competitive advantage in rare disease. I absolutely believe that. The world needs a place where gene therapies and other wonderful therapies can bring back hope to families who need it, not just across the kingdom and across the Persian Gulf, but around the world. Coming here today has invigorated me to believe this is the day. All things change. Have a takeaway today. Believe that what you are doing is buying time for better science. Ryan is here. He's waiting for better science. It can be developed here. Thank you for meeting. Thank you for inviting me to tell our story. And please let me know how we can help because I'm excited about what you're building. Thank you.